Hello and welcome back. We are in the National Program on Technology Enhanced Learning, NPTEL, which is under a joint venture of the Indian Institutes of Technology and Indian Institute of Science. We are in the domain of English literature and language, and today we are going to present the fourth module, Literary Genres and Lecture 3. I am Krishna Barua. I teach English at the Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati. And let us look into the review of what we had done in the first two lectures. Literary genres, as such, we have seen, is a specific type of classification for works of art, literature, music, characterized by style, technique, form, etc. We have also seen that this common definition is that it covers major genres of poetry, drama and novel and fiction, etc. So, these genres, as we have done, we had already done novel and poetry, and today we are going to do drama. In lecture 1, if you remember, we had defined the novel, the structural aspect, the technical aspect, the evolution of novel as such, and the design and representation in all its storytelling method. In lecture 2, especially poetry, which was something very, very illustrative, we could see that poetic devices which were employed, how is rhythm being managed, what are the arrangement of words, what kinds of comparisons we use, figures of speech we use for the ornamentation of style. So, today we are going to the most dynamic of all these genres, and that is drama. And originally, as we have seen from the time of the Greeks, from Aristotle and Plato, this was identified with poetry. Drama was a part of the poetic form, and the dramatic mode was interspersed with epic lyrics. Somewhere we see that play acting and ritual drama had a large part in determining what was drama about. If we look into the etymological meaning of the word drama, it means to do or to act. So, a play is a story acted out, it is performed. Drama therefore begins in make believe and is something which is enacted on the stage. This is the difference between drama and the other genres that we have been doing. This is almost connected with the visual art. And as it began in the ritual of primitive religion, it never forsake in any period of time its primitive beginnings, for imitative action is its essence. Just now I told you that it is mostly for the way that drama imitated life, and because it was a representational form of literature, therefore, there was a lot of technique involved in the visual culture. Thus, like play acting and ritual drama, let us note, it creates its experience by doing things that can be heard and seen. So, therefore, which is not there in novel, or which was not there in some sense, it was there in poetry about sound and when you read out poem, but here what you can see and what you can hear, these are things which are very sensory details, which are very, very important in the appreciation of drama. And the things it does, as with play acting and ritual, what does it do? It creates another imaginary world, a world modeled on ours, yet leading to its own charmed existence. You can say that it is something which is almost based on another alternate existence. So, let us see. The earliest recorded system of genre in Western traditions, we have already seen in novel, we have seen in poetry, could be traced back to Plato and Aristotle. Plato had three imitational genres, imitation based on the mimetic theory. Mimesis is imitation, right? First he gave dramatic dialogue, mind you, he calls it dramatic dialogue, then pure narrative, then epic, which is a mixture of dialogue and narrative. Now, the Poetics is in part Aristotle. When Aristotle wrote the Poetics, it was a response to Plato's idea of these genres in his Republic. He wanted to show that poetry is not just mere representation of mere appearances, right. So, if we go back to dramatic theory as such, we can go back in the West to Aristotle Poetics about 300 BC and Bharat Muni's Natya Sastra in Indian dramatic theory, which is about 200 BC, right. Well, let us look now, even though we had done that last time, how he had given his ideas on representation. The first ever work on theory in drama, it has been said, because he has worked upon Plato's theory on the genres, and he gives therefore more emphasis on the dramatic mode. And it was published around 335 BC, four types of classical genres. So, he makes it into four categories. First, the highest form of the genres, literary genres, he calls tragedy, which he says is so superior of a high quality, and that is dramatic dialogue. The second is epic, superior mixed narrative, like we have the epic poems of Milton, or we can have Homer's Odyssey. Comedy is lower down the line, and it is inferior dramatic monologue. Then parody is inferior mixed narrative. Now, it is very interesting actually, when Aristotle laid down in his Poetics what drama should be, what would be basically the rules of which govern drama, especially that of tragedy. And he did it on the analysis of Sophocles' Oedipus Rex. Okay? He had said that tragedy is an imitation of an action. Please see that, imitation of an action which is serious, complete, and of a certain magnitude. The meaning of magnitude, the length, the time, the rhythm, the movement is very important. It should arouse pity and fear in the audience as it witnesses the action, right? And which should give, it is like a purgation of your mind. So, consciousness is being developed, right? And therefore, the onus is on the audience, right? And we will go more into it later, the meaning of the audience and the writer and the drama related responses, and which will bring in a catharsis of emotion, which is almost like a purgation of all your emotions, and which will lead to the to a different sort of higher consciousness. He also defined the tragic hero. He is otherwise an ordinary man, of course, he belongs to a high estate, not an ordinary man in the true sense of the term, but he has extraordinary, you can say, feelings, and he suffers because of a tragic flaw, which is called hamartia, which may be pride or hubris or whatever, and which will lead or make or unmake his fortune. So, these rules were laid out by Aristotle in his Poetics. Well, now let us look into the essential quality of this enactment, of how it is being performed. We have to envision the words in performance. All the words have impact, right? So, we have to go into performance theory, or from the perspective of how you are seeing the drama, right? And dramas are not to be, even though we can read a drama, Hamlet can be read as well as performed, but at the same time we know that it is the visual contact which is the most important aspect in drama. So, when we look into all these great classics, Sophocles' Antigone, William Shakespeare's Hamlet, Ibsen's Doll's House, Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman, Edward Albee's The Jew's Story, Pinter's The Dumb Waiter, even Chinese author Gao Xinjian's Dialogue and Rebuttal. What do we find in common? Do we find that they are concerned with the same modes of representation, or are they evolving their own manner of writing a drama, or are the characters, the plot, the theme differs from one another, right? So, this takes us back to the core of the way of understanding drama, right? So, this task of redefinition of techniques of form is carried out by the aesthetic theories of visibility and performance. As students of engineering streams, I think you are always concerned with design and form and structure, especially in the literary genres, as we have gone through all, not all, whatever we have done of the literary genres till now, we have seen that the rules and the systematic methodology of how it is represented is equally important as in a scientific treatise, in a treatise, isn't it? So, let us look into it, the mimetic theory, right, which is imitation, and the diegesis theory, which is narration. So, is there a link between narration and imitation? This has been contrasted since Plato's and Aristotle's times. When you look, when you go and see a drama or you go and see a film, all right, there is a difference between drama and a film. Film is something where there is no direct contact with the audience, okay? It is being enacted and there is no face to face response. But in a drama, there is this face to face response with the audience, and therefore, you have to understand, which I had told you earlier, that what is important in the appreciation of drama is this collective consciousness which grows out. Arthur Miller, I think he called it in the preface to All My Sons, the organic form of understanding drama. There is an organic structure where it is a collective whole which ultimately makes it so beautiful. Right? When everyone looks in, sees or goes to see a drama, then what happens? Then this collective response is much more worthwhile than just reading the play in the cocoon of your room, right? Well, so what we had just told you just now, mimesis shows the beauty of nature rather than tales, while diegesis, however, is the telling of the story by the narrator. Well, so while we are doing this module, we see that drama as a literary genre is an art form that is meant to be performed. It is at once therefore literary as well as visual art. It also goes into the margin of the visual culture. We have to imagine life on the stage. So, it rests with us, the imagination, which is not only the script writer or the dramatist or the playwright, but the person who sees. So, it is a recreation of the flow of human life before a live audience in a specific place. So, this specific place, the setting, the theater hall, or how it is being enacted is equally, it holds ground. It is drama if you define it as a fiction acted out rather than narrated on the stage, experienced collectively, a collaborative effort of design, stagecraft, cumulative efforts of author, director, actor, technician, designer, lights, props, you see it and you have it. Music and dance, of course, are integral parts of drama. Now, especially in modern drama, when you have so many technological advances in the presentation of drama, you find that it is an extension of the visual art as a representation. Well, so, if we go into the six elements of drama as such, what are the six elements of drama as Aristotle had laid out? Okay? There is no escape from Aristotle when we go into Western traditions, right? And it is almost the base of what he had said about what poetics was about. He gave the six elements a thought or theme on ideas, which is different from plot, mind you. And theme is the idea, right, which is opposed to what happens in the plot. Sometimes the theme is clearly stated in the title, sometimes it occurs as a leitmotif, or it is something as a repetition, which you will have to understand the moral behind it. Second is the action, the plot, Okay, this is very interesting, all right, because the plot ultimately is how you are structuring the play, right, whether you are dividing the first act into 3 or 4 scenes or into 5 scenes or only 1 scene, again how the second act goes, how it will go again into the third act, right. So, this will be following triad of development almost, as Aristotle had said that there was a triad of development in the plot. First is the opening, you begin or you introduce the characters or the theme, and then after that you have the developing of the action, then it goes into a rising scale, ultimately the reversal or the way that it is develops into the denouement or the end, right. Now, the third is the characters, right. So, in a drama you cannot do away with characters, right. Of course, there have been different modifications or innovations in modern drama where characters have been put into the background by somewhere the language describes the theme, where we talk about existential drama as such. Okay. But here if we talk about classical drama or we look into the dramas of Shakespeare, take for example, Hamlet, we will find that the character, how he develops from, there is a growth from state of innocence to the state of from enlightenment, right. So, the characters themselves can be round, can be flat, as we had done in the novel. Language, which is very important, the dialogues that are presented, how it is presented, what are the ways that the characters discourse, interaction with them, and another aspect which Aristotle said was music, right, which adds to the theme. Music does not mean only the background music or the way music is implemented on the stage, it also talks about the rhythm in the dialogue, right, even in the way that the characters talk with themselves, right. And the most important aspect which Aristotle had said, mind you, that was in 300 BC, right, that he had said about spectacle. Spectacle is what? If you come to really the nitty gritties of drama, dramatic presentation, you will know that this is the stagecraft, what the stage is about, aspects of scenery, costumes, special effects in a production, the visual elements of the play created for theatrical event, equally important in a drama. So, you understand it is not only the text which is important or which really allows the drama to move or to have an impact, but these are the props or these are the all elements which was laid out by Aristotle, right. Therefore, the structure of dramatic text, if we look into it, Gustav Freytag's analysis of ancient Greek and Shakespearean drama is very interesting. He divides it into 5 parts. Therefore, as we have said, the first is the exposition or the initiation, as we find in the novel too, then the rising action, then it goes to the turning point, it is like a triangle or the turning point, then it comes back, the falling action or the reversal of the action, and then the resolution, whatever you come to a conclusion, which is called denouement in comedy or catastrophe in tragedy. A visual aid for Freytag's analysis of dramatic structure is Freytag's pyramid, also known as a plot mountain. So, Freytag had also outlined this as the pyramid, which he calls it the plot mountain. We have a drawing like this, where it goes from the exposition, the rising action, climax, falling action, denouement. Next time you go to see a drama, please see to it that does it follow this plot pyramid or not, right, and then you will be able to appreciate the drama quite well. Well, whatever that may be, a plot, what Aristotle had said and what other dramatists have insisted upon, is the soul of tragedy, because action is paramount to the significance of a drama. Tragedy, because not comedy, they have emphasized here from the time of the from the Greeks, the tragedy is the highest form of drama and comedy is somewhere it falls in the lower shelf of presentation. A plot must have a beginning, a middle and an end, as in on storytelling. It must also be universal in significance, have a determinate structure, and then it should maintain a unity of theme and purpose. This unity of theme, the subplots or the plots which are there should have a story which has somehow it should have a leitmotif, it should be parallel to the main theme. It should not be a discordant element, an outside element which has no connection with the plot. Now, this brings me to another topic, another area of drama which we do not have in the other genres that we had done. The difference between drama and theatre, the place where drama is enacted. This is equally important, the theatre, right? So, what are the basic elements of theatre? Specific place of the performance is also named by the word theatre. This also has a Greek meaning which is said the place for viewing. In this place for viewing, even the place with its physical presence, it has the outside element coming in, which is the script and the text, how it has to be enacted, then the scenario, then the process in which it will be enacted, then the audience, which I have told you from the beginning, you as audience are more important than the drama, than the actors who are enacting the part, right? We have the box office hits, etcetera, don't we? Right? And we know that if the audience receives a play, audience understands a play, then it becomes a best hit, right? And many have paid credit to the Elizabethan audience, right, that it gave due value. Even the not the very elite, even the lowest class of people could understand Shakespeare, and it was because of the popularity of Shakespeare's plays among all classes of people that Shakespeare still is Shakespeare, right? Therefore, the audience is what is the main dynamic force, and theatre is a living, dynamic, breathing art form. Okay? It can destroy the playwright, it can destroy the drama, or it can even make it. Well, the basic categories of drama, on the other hand, can be generally divided into the genre. Coming from Aristotle's definitions of genre, we can now divide it into tragedy, comedy, melodrama, tragic comedy, musicals, the opera, right? Of course, music is almost in every part of this genres, right? But in the musicals, it is where people sing, the music is the prominent element, and in the opera too, music is the prominent element in the enactment of the theme. Well, so let us go into the evolution of the theatres, right? While we are talking of the structuring of the plays, right, we will have to see how, in what place was the drama was enacted. As we have said earlier, that it did begin with the primitive rituals, it did begin with play acting, maybe with children acting a part, maybe with little bits of imitations, but the technical terminology actually came into form when the Greeks invented two kinds of drama. While they were honoring, they were enacting performance during ceremonies to honor the Greek god Dionysus. Okay? Originally, it was a chorus. There was not a drama as in the true sense of the term, but this were like a group of 50 men or women, not women, and boys who danced and chanted lines in unison. So, it was a big group, a chorus, and this was called a goat song or tragos, which is the basis for the word tragedy. Ultimately, tragedy came to be there and to be formed, and it is said to be the invention of Thespis, who brought from the chorus a different aside of dialogues and became the first actor. That's why we have the word thespian when we talk about acting, a mature actor, right? So, who were the great classic greats in dramatic writing? Aeschylus, Sophocles, Euripides, and Aristophanes, who wrote comedies, were all the most talented of Greek playwrights, and the plays performed several times during the year. And when were they performed? as part of religious and agricultural festival. So, we see how from the chorus the dialogue has been brought in, it intrudes into the chorus, or from the chorus it comes into dialogue enactment, and that is how we find that the tragedies were being formed. Well, when we look into the theater of the Greeks, right, this is the Greek theater took place in large hillside amphitheaters, open amphitheaters, this was called amphitheaters. The players included the chorus and the leader, and the lines were more chanted than spoken. You just see the structure of the amphitheater, right? Okay. Like the Greek theater, the Romans do use the facade stage, right? Though here the facade is much more elaborate. Yet the architecture of the classical facade stage still makes for drama and dramatic performances quite different from modern proscenium or truss stages. When you have the proscenium or the truss stages where you can see the drama as only from the front view. For one thing, unlike the Greeks, the Romans typically build their theaters on flat sides. Okay, the Greeks of course had it on the hillside, so that everyone could have a view on that on all sides, combining the acting areas and the sitting areas into a single structure. So, the Roman structure is much more modern than the Greeks. We have a visual here of the Roman amphitheater, 3rd century BC, Colosseum, most of you know about that, famous playwrights of that time, Plautus, especially in comedy, he brought out the stock characters, the meaning of typical types in life, and Seneca's Oedipus, 1st century AD, some of the Roman playwrights who had greatly influenced European theater. So, in the England of the 15th, if we come back to the England of the 15th and 16th centuries, we are just talking of the structure of the theater, not talking of drama as such. Okay. The stages on which the works of a growing body of playmakers were performed evolved from the use of enclosed courtyards of inns to stage performances. From the search it had gone to inns or stage performances, from there these apron stages, this were called, were surrounded by galleries and therefore open stages. Even in Shakespeare's time, when you look into the architecture of the Globe Theater, you will find that it is somewhere open. The stage is open to all the audience. The groundlings used to be on the ground, and the rest, some of those who had the privilege, used to take up the upper seats. Indeed, they were so open that members of the audience not only sat in the gallery surrounding the stage on three sides, in the ground space around the elevated stage, but on the stage itself. So, there have been instances where the groundlings used to. So, this is a drawing of the Swan. All right, one of the theaters during Shakespeare's time, Elizabethan times, right. I just telling you how this amphitheater, the concept of the proscenium and the truss theater has given place to this type of the playhouse. But during the restoration, you will find that the stage becomes different, the stage is the stage that we are used to. Okay. So, let us look into the origin of drama as such, as in Greece and Rome, right. But it has also in religious practice. Rituals play a great part in dramatic performance, and we have to take into account what are the different cultural indicators in the way that the dramatic performance is being enacted. It was in fact creation of a church. Many have said that rituals have been such a prominent indicator in the development of drama, that most of the dramatic performances have originated in the places of worship. Now, the Romans may have introduced drama to England, but it was the folk tales. It may have been also something which was enacted in the folk tales and the retelling of old fables, when people used to tell one thing from the other, and actors traveling from one place to another, and the mode became popular. In the poetry section, when we did that, we mentioned the troubadours of France, didn't we? And when we mentioned that he used to enact a part whenever the life of a saint or some story has been told. So, the actor becomes a traveling minstrel, right? He is a singer, he is a performer, all in one. And more so, it was after the Norman conquest that the vernacular plays following the French pattern were produced. Before that, it was more or less imitation of what the European influences were seen. So, the first stage in the development of the English drama is discerned in such scriptural performances, right, inside the search premises by searchmen, notwithstanding that the influence of the folk or of the fables, we find that literally speaking, the drama began in the search. From the liturgical origin of the drama came its earliest pieces. What were they? They were the mysteries and the miracles, the two types of scriptural plays. If we go into the history of drama in England, right, then we will find that this were the mystery and the miracle plays were performed at religious festivals. Okay. But English drama before, therefore, 16th century is of mainly academic and historical interest. Why? Why so? We will have to see that there are occasional plays which possess charm and liveliness. Ultimate origins of all drama are concern of the anthropologist too, rather than of the literary historian. This is a point to make up, because drama and religious rituals seem to have been bound up with each other in the earlier stages of all civilization. Folk celebrations, ritual miming of such elemental themes such as death, resurrection, seasonal festivals, this lies in the background of all drama. Well, when did the transition then take place? The transition took place in the mid 15th century, right? After the mystery and the miracle take place, the new type of drama emerged was called the morality plays. Here, the subject matter became more allegorical, it became more abstract. Good was represented as a form, or evil or the devil was represented as an abstraction, and that is how the moralities came into being. The transition from the scriptural figures of the former plays to the abstraction of the latter, where we find the Coventry cycles which was enacted from place to place. In the evolution of British drama, therefore, what do we see? This transition from the mystery to the morality forms the third stage, right? Of all the moral plays of medieval England, therefore, Everyman is the most celebrated and recognized one is Everyman, and where we see the progress of Everyman from the state of ignorance to that of redemption or to enlightenment. Well, so it was the influence of the continent that the Renaissance came to English theatre. Now, let us come to the most colourful period in English drama in England, right? The English drama, like other literary branches, had the enlivening influence from Italy to register significant strides, right? From the medieval mystery and morality plays, therefore, we have seen there was sweeping advancement to regular. Now, we are the topic of drama has enlarged. The Renaissance has given in access to broader themes, more enlarged vision of the world, tragedies, history plays. The main source of inspiration of course, the English tragedy was Seneca, a Latin dramatist of the age of Nero. The first English tragedy during this time was Gorboduc, written by Thomas Naunton, and therefore, we understand now the Greek influence, the Roman influence and the Italian face. And the other hand, Terence and Plautus were the great Italian masters to inspire the earliest English comedies. This Roman influence continues. The first comedy therefore produced was Ralph Doister and Gamma Gayton's Needle. Yes, we now come to the late 16th century and early 17th century. Who is the central son? This was the age when we have done in our genre on poetry, that this was the Elizabethan age, was the age where was a nest of singing birds. It can be also said to be the nest of dramatists. It was in this world that William Shakespeare, 1564 to 1616, it has been said the age of Shakespeare, because the whole has been identified by the dramas of Shakespeare, enacted in his plays in the late 16th and early 17th century. Elizabethan and Jacobean theatre produced a number of notable playwrights, the university wits, which included Christopher Marlowe, Thomas Gage, John Lyly, Green and Ben Jonson, but Shakespeare towers above them. Who does not know about Shakespeare's plays, his tragedies, King Lear, Othello, Hamlet, his comedies, his romances, his historical plays, Julius Caesar. We have his late romances like Tempest. He experimented with every form of drama, every theme of drama, and he can be said to be the master of all dramatists. As seen from Hamlet, okay, supposed to be the masterpiece on dramatic presentation, it has all the elements which we have discussed in drama, whether in setting, in character, in design, in spectacle, everything else. From Othello here, then from the time of the Elizabethans, we come to the 17th century, right. So, there was a lapse in this period. English theatres were kept closed by the Puritans for religious and ideological reasons. When the London theatres opened again with the restoration, right, so of the monarchy, they flourished under personal interest and support of Charles II. Well, even so, the introduction, one important aspect was during the restoration, the 17th century, it was the for the first time that women acted as in the stage, first professional actresses. Now, here we have found new genres of the drama of the restoration, where the heroic play and restoration comedy, which were polished, very artificial form of dramatic presentation based on wit, on sexual explicitness. And we have notable heroic tragedies of this period like Dryden's All for Love, and we have Etheridge's The Man of Mode, Wycherley's The Country Wife, William Congreve's very lively comedy The Way of the World. Okay? So, here the genre has taken on a different form altogether, comedy, and we find here that it has experimented not only with the character, but also with style, with technique, and also with the way that you present it, right. So, theatre in England, if we see in the 18th century, was dominated by David Garrick, who was a very well known actor, he was manager as well. His performances had a tremendous impact on the art of acting, okay, from which ultimately grew movements such as realism and naturalism. From a actor acting a part, he could bring out a movement in a change in the mode of dramatic presentation. So, now we come in the 18th century, that plays dealt with ordinary people as characters, such as Stoops to Conquer by Oliver Goldsmith, mid of 18th century, School for Scandal, Richard Sheridan, which are very, very popular dramas. Now, the growing desire for freedom both in Europe and North America again brought in different modes of representation. It was also in the 18th century that commercial theatre, of course, theatre became commercial during the time of Shakespeare, as long as the monarchy tried, gave patronage, right, and before it was by the patronage of the aristocracy or by the monarchy. Later, with the printing press and everything else, right, we find that theatre became, drama became commercial. But it was also in the 18th century that commercial theatre began to make its appearance in the colonies of North America. So, during the 19th century, if we come back to the evolving of theatre now or drama in England. The Industrial Revolution, we had seen in poetry as well as in the novel, especially in the novel, right, how, what was the impact of the Industrial Revolution, the growth of the middle class, literary reading public changed the way people lived and worked, and it changed the face of theatre as well. Playwrights such as Henrik Ibsen, George Bernard Shaw, it was not art for art's sake. Dramas had to be written for life's sake, it had to have a moral, it had to have a purpose. And Anton Chekhov and Oscar Wilde we find this who were the thinkers, who were the scholars, even in the way that they wanted to present drama to the public. So, by the end of the 20th century, with the two wars in history, we find that the saint's mindset was different, and therefore, there were movements such as realism, naturalism, symbolism, impressionism, as it followed the parallel movement in the visual arts, in painting, in sculpture, anti-realism. All this also reflected in the way of dramatic procedures, particularly in the early 20th century. We have serious drama in the works of Eugene O'Neill, in his trilogy Mourning Becomes Electra. All this have become classics. Modern classics, Arthur Miller, Death of a Salesman, All My Sons, The Crucible, and Tennessee Williams' Glass Menagerie, where tragedy, the whole form of tragedy was changed. The history of theater in the 18th, 19th and 20th centuries, therefore, what does it show? It's one of the increasing commercialization of the art. Yes, we are familiar with that, aren't we? Accompanied by technological innovations, the introduction of serious critical review, expansion of the subject matters portrayed to include ordinary people, ordinary views, and an emphasis on more natural forms of acting. This is Waiting for Godot by Samuel Beckett, absurd play, which talked about two persons, Estrasen and Vladimir. They wait and wait and wait, right? And this is emptiness of the plot makes the audience wonder if anything is going to happen. A landmark in absurd drama, right? We have another scene here of Arthur Miller's All My Sons, where the stagecraft, the importance of the stagecraft, all right, the stage directions which has been given in the play, it occupies almost most of the place of the drama. And it has to be very minutely presented, and it becomes a character by itself, the backdrop by itself becomes a character in the plot. Yes. So, I hope by now you have come to understand what is drama about, right? And next time you go to see a play and you see the way the play, you respond to the play, you look into the organic structure of the play, you being a part of the organic structure. Right? Because the audience is the most important participant of the dramatic performance, and in doing that, I hope you will be able to understand the way dramas are enacted. Well, suppose I ask you a question, what are the different types of drama? Would you be able to answer that question? Right? Going back from Aristotle, how it has been innovated, or how it has been reformed, or how it has been changed. You cannot just put it into categories of comedy, tragedy, and the different tragic comedies. You see that sometimes a comedy also verges on the tragic comedies, and a tragedy also verges on the comic, right? So here we have different types of drama, yes, but at the same time, experiments are going on where there is an approach which leads to interdisciplinary areas of enactment. On the stage, character must be created solely through action, behavior and speech, isn't it? Compare the scale with which dramatists create an impression of the characters in the play. If you take Shakespeare's Hamlet, right, and you see that the way Hamlet emotes on the stage, is it because of the lines which has been given, or is it because of the character? Because of the language, and you will find in Shakespeare's play the soliloquy, which was the monologue, was an important part of the play, where he used to reveal what was going to happen to him, the changes in his temperament, what is the trauma that is undergoing, right? Yeah. Setting now can often reflect the underlying ideas in a play. Just now I referred to you Arthur Miller's backstage. The whole action takes place in the backyard of a home. In the light of this statement, consider the importance and use of setting in two or three plays you have studied. Okay? In whatever plays you have studied, suppose again you take for example Hamlet, it starts in the twilight hours, all right, when there is a difference between the light and darkness, right? And the eerie atmosphere, the setting of the ramparts, where there is so much of loneliness and aloneness, it itself indicates the theme of the play. Plays are rarely entirely tragic or comic, but a mixture of the two. I think I have already told you that. Using two or three plays you have studied, say how far you would agree with the statement, right? You can even go into a really live play, drama, not a film, right? As I told you, the film is something where you do not have face-to-face response. Yeah, those are also the way that you can see a drama. Dramas are films, but at the same time it is the script writer who changes the text from to the film, but yet you do not have the dynamic interrelation when you see a drama in its live audience, as a live audience. Well, some of these discussions that you can take part in: the opening scenes of at least two plays. You just see how it opens, how it ends. Aristotle said that it should be of proper magnitude, that it should know when it should end. It should not be extended so that the interest is not decreased. In dramatic construction, there must be variation of pace and rhythm, monotony of any kind being certain to induce boredom. Some of the key source texts in this lecture, right? The History of Drama, Elements of Literature. Thank you.